All right, so to kick us off, I mentioned that we are going to be talking about sustainable aviation fuel, and I have to imagine not everybody knows exactly what that is, so never fear, we have a video to explain it to you. We are going to give you a short overview of what SAF is, thanks to this great video, and then we will dive into some questions, so let's watch.
As climate action takes off, our need to decarbonize intensifies. The aviation industry has committed to a long-term goal of net zero carbon emissions. And for air travel, this is no easy task. While electric and hydrogen alternatives will develop for some flights in the future, today, sustainable aviation fuel, or SAF for short, is our best, most scalable solution. Most SAF is made from bio-based and waste raw materials, such as energy crops, used cooking oil, and industrial waste. It's then blended with jet fuels, ready to perform in commercial engines. From field to flight, SAF has the potential to lower carbon emissions by up to 80%. And organizations like the Roundtable on Sustainable Biomaterials ensure its production protects people as well as our planet. Drop-in SAF gives aviation the strongest chance of halving net carbon emissions by 2050 without modifying aircrafts. But to make SAF more widely available and affordable, we must immediately remove barriers to boost production and the market sustainably. The switch to SAF marks a moment in time where we can choose to innovate aviation for good and fuel a brighter future in flight. To learn more about how you can make a truly sustainable switch to SAF, visit our website.
So Ryan, we just heard that sustainable aviation fuel, or SAF, is the most viable short-term way for airlines to decarbonize. Can you explain us why that is?
Yeah, it's a great question. And really the challenge with flights is fuel, right? And that's what we're thinking about, and that's what the infrastructure's been for as long as we've been flying. The challenge with some of the technologies that we're really excited about in like automobiles, EVs, it's just not there yet. And it's not there on a scale or at the size that we need to make a difference in the flights that we're taking every day, especially the long haul. And so when you think about SAF as the solution, it's drop-in, as the video said, right now. It can go into the infrastructure that we already have right now, which has the benefit of obviously working and being safe, but also is one of those opportunities where we're trying to lower the cost, right? We don't want everyone to feel the impacts of the cost of SAF, and today SAF is very expensive and there's not quite nearly enough of it, which we're all trying to work on doing, improving. So that's why we really think in the short term, hey, we can put this into the planes, we can make a difference, and we can scale it quickly.
So Ryan, before you can use the SAF, we need John to make the SAF. So John, explain to us the difference. Are there different qualities of SAF, and how are you thinking about the policies around the encouragement of the creation of it?
Sure. So first of all, thanks everybody for participating. It's great to see this big of an audience interested in the topic. I've been in the sustainable aviation fuel space since the very beginning. One of my previous companies and roles was the first producer of SAF in 2007, used in a Boeing 747 in 2008 with Virgin Atlantic. And it's been a super interesting industry to sort of try to get moving. And I think we're right on the tipping point of scale. And there are a number of challenges that have been overcome. It's been demonstrated at hundreds of thousands of flights. It's got terrific sponsorship from Alaska Airlines and Microsoft and many others. So really where we're at today is sort of getting the industry from a concept into wide scale use so that there's enough availability for airlines to consume it and enough for corporate clients like Microsoft to support it on a meaningful scale. And so from our perspective, the real risk today is twofold. One, wide scale adoption for a more expensive product than petroleum. And we should talk about what that means. And then policy. And I think policy is a is a topic that we could spend about 4 hours on and still not dive into it. But as you think about policy, feedstocks, and technologies, we really have to differentiate. The most important policy is one that incentivizes performance on carbon mitigation. So think of a low carbon fuel standard as the most elegant policy in the US that is incentive based. That includes the Washington State Clean Fuels Program. It includes 45Z under the IRA, which is the CFPC, which I can never remember what it stands for. But basically incentivizing carbon reduction then allows companies like Sky Energy to go find feedstocks, which is where your carbon intensity is really derived from, that has the lowest carbon intensity, which then allows both the airline and the corporate client to meet their milestone-based goals of emission reduction. So Alaska has a great goal of, was it net zero by
2040.
Yeah, thank you. And so this really relates to both policy and technology. And I think a really key important distinction is not all SAF is equal. There's sustainable aviation fuel that can be produced from corn ethanol all the way to DAC. And hydrogen, so CO2 and hydrogen, often called PTL, and lots of stuff in between. And so as you start to think about policy, sustainability, corporate sort of voluntary mechanisms, you really have to focus on what we would call, and we're paraphrasing, we stole it from one of our customers, capital S SAF. So really the importance from my perspective that we think about is we enable the industry to not only scale, but we do it in a manner that doesn't create other sustainability challenges. For example, for Sky Energy's perspective, using food for fuel is a non-starter. And so really, I think as we start to scale the industry, we have to make sure we don't create uncertain or unique challenges downstream. And that loops back to policy, and where I think policy is really important, that it becomes critical. And then the last thing on policy, and I'll shut up, is the US does it with a carrot, and I'm not sure that's a good solution, because an investor who wants to invest in SAF and is going to spend, let's say, $1 billion on a facility wants to feel certainty that that market of incentives are going to be there. And the US is really bad at having long-term incentives for the energy transition. You only have to look at wind and solar to see that cyclical nature has been really challenging. Where in Europe, they've created a much different market, and that's a stick or a mandate. And beginning in 2025 all the way through to 2050, there is a guaranteed market for both the producers and the consumers, the obligated party, which is the airline, that has to buy it. And I think going forward, the more we can see that long-term certainty on policy that is either in an incentive for 10 to 20 years or in a mandate for 25 years, that's the best path.
And Melanie, what role can corporates like Microsoft play in helping to make sure that we're able to develop enough of that high-quality SAF, and also that Ryan and his team are able to get that and put that into their plans? How can you help them?
Well, I think it's really great to have such a diverse panel here. We joked in the green room, it's sort of make, buy, sell, and so you get this whole range featured here on the panel. I think the role that corporations play is so vital to this ecosystem. You know, if you take a look at any company, it's really hard-pressed to find a company that doesn't travel or doesn't use some form of aviation fuel in their business. And so for a company like Microsoft, when we report our emissions, we report across all the scopes, our direct emissions and our indirect emissions, of which fuel is one of the, you know, large wedges of our indirect procurement and our indirect emissions category. And so when we think about as a sustainability team, how do we start to bring emissions down across each of those wedges? 96% of Microsoft's reported emissions come from that scope 3, and a category of that that's fairly large is fuels. So we start there as a starting point of where corporations, why corporations even come into this conversation is, where are those interventions we can apply that start to bring down the embodied carbon or the carbon intensity of what we produce and what we engage in as a business? Then the next role of then what do you do about it, this is where it gets really exciting. For a company like Microsoft, there are three ways we engage in this space. The first is to signal demand. You know, we continue to be a very large corporate purchaser of sustainable aviation fuel to showcase that there is demand in the marketplace for what Sky Energy is producing and a variety of other players that are out there. The second key area is how do we collaborate on innovation? So this is a great example as a partnership that we have with Alaska and an innovative company called 12 based here in Washington State that is producing a type of SAF. And from this company, you know, they wanted to then fly the SAF in Alaska's planes. So we formed this kind of trifecta of a partnership where we can invest in the green attributes of the 12 fuel. They can fly on it, and then everybody is part of this ecosystem, and we're driving more demand and then the actual access to and supply of a fuel like that. And the third area for corporations is really around this idea around how can we pilot innovative financial mechanisms? Because the other piece to it is you have, you know, state and federal incentives, but you also need corporations that can be part of this innovative financing structure. So whether it's the work we've done in the video you saw today with the Roundtable on Sustainable Biomaterials, or the work we're doing with the Sustainable Aviation Buyers Alliance as a founding member called SABA, how are we looking at innovative financing in this model called book and claim or virtualization that's allowing greater investment into the creation of SAF, the use of SAF, and the utilization of SAF to reduce carbon intensity of any corporate or others' carbon intensity across their business. So those are sort of the three areas that I think corporations can play. And many of us have been first movers in this space, which we're really proud of. And with every first mover, you need a second and a third and a fourth. And so the more we can tell our story and fill rooms like this, ideally there'll be more second, third, and fourth users of it that then just grow this market. So you see that airplane curve of growth that was in the video we just saw.
Yeah, I'd like to touch on that too. You know, Microsoft is obviously helping us a lot with this area. But this isn't the first time you've done it either. The things that we're seeing in the renewable energy market started 15, 20 years ago with these exact type of partnerships. And that's why it's exciting to have Bloomberg here and to meet other companies that are thinking about how do I build a new market? A new market that is gonna make a better product than the one that we have today. And so I just wanna, you know, say thank you, first of all, but also we've seen this playbook before. So we know that we can be successful. Renewables are now the cheapest form of energy they've ever been. My hope is that in a few years, SAF will be the cheapest form, probably faster or more ambitious than it's gonna happen, but that's what we need, and that's why we're here, is the ambition to find these solutions.
Melanie, are you taking any tools from the playbook that you used for renewables and applying them to SAF? Are there learnings that you're bringing to this new challenge?
Well, definitely the creative partnerships. I mean, this is, like anything in the sustainability space, this is a team sport. It is a group effort, and no one company can do it alone. And so that's the first and foremost what we saw in renewables. The other place we're actually learning a lot from when it comes to market creation, because this is kind of that space as well for SAF, is what we've done in the carbon removal space. As a large corporate buyer of high durability carbon dioxide removal, which is a newer market as well, the lessons we've learned there is not only the partnerships, it's the transparency around methodology and diligence that we do to ensure that we're getting the high durability or the high quality that's out there, and then publishing that with consistency. So we put out 3 white papers on CDR that talk about the contracts we signed, the methodologies we use. And as both John and Ryan noted, it's the methodologies and that transparency that's so critical. You know, he mentioned not all SAF is alike. Not all CDR is alike either. And so in these markets that you want to see continue to grow and scale at the pace that science requires, I think a good lesson we've learned is how to be transparent with what we're buying, what we're doing, so that others get more comfortable and actually can join us in it.
John, SAF production and use is still quite small. So what do you need to grow?
It's a great point. So Sky Energy is developing 3 projects. The project that is sort of the first in the U.S. that we're developing is here in Washington. It's in eastern Washington, and it has to go through numerous stages. The stage we're in right now is the permitting stage. Each of these steps is multiple years, and so it's a long, big effort. But think about what we're trying to build. We're trying to build a refinery that we haven't built before in the United States, meaning a refinery that converts an input into a hydrocarbon kerosene. And so these are big investments. They require billions of dollars. Sky Energy has been lucky enough to recently receive €175 million from an investment group called Macquarie. And those are the types of investors that we need along with support from off-takers like Alaska Airlines and corporate partners like Microsoft to actually build the capacity. That's the fundamental problem we have today, is created an environment that gives investors confidence to build the facility, to make the product so everybody can use it. And that's the number one challenge in an environment where we have political instability. And obviously we have a lot of political instability right now. And so navigating that, I think, can be done in a really unique manner. And one of the things we talked about is why Washington? And Washington's put in some really attractive, from my perspective, best policy in the country, because not only do we have the Clean Fuels Program, but we have a SAF-specific incentive for in-state produced and consumed sustainable aviation fuel. And it's worth up to $2 a gallon. It's a performance-based metric. So the lower the carbon intensity, if you get to zero, you get the $2. And it's a 10-year incentive. So that type of policy then gives investors like Macquarie and others confidence, here's an opportunity for us to invest and begin this industry. And that's really where we've been for the last decade, is trying to create an environment that gives investors confidence to build these big investments.
Raise your hand if you flew to attend this conference, to attend the festival. A decent amount of people. Ryan, what do you want them to know about SAF? What do you want these individual people to know?
So, you know, I think a lot of airlines are looking at this. All the U.S. airlines, certainly all the European airlines are looking at this. And we are trying to, of course, engage corporate customers that have, you know, funds and goals around emissions. But you also have choices you can make. And one of the things that we're super encouraged about is people that are flying Alaska right now are making the choice to actually buy some SAF. And they're doing that completely voluntarily. In December, we had a promotion. And if you bought SAF voluntarily outside the when you were buying your ticket, we gave you some elite qualifying miles. Obviously, that's a nice benefit. It's a nice carrot. We saw people buy over 500,000 gallons of SAF in just those 30 days. In May, we launched the ability for you to actually buy it right when you're buying your ticket. So if you saw trip insurance, right, you can also now offset a little bit of the cost of SAF. And we're seeing thousands of customers voluntarily use their dollars. Now, I understand every dollar matters to every person in this room. And so there are choices that you can make along the day and when you're thinking about flying that can actually help this industry. The other piece is just talking about it. You know, John talked about the policy here in Washington State, obviously an incredible a policy that's been put in place. But on the federal level as well, right, we want to see the SAF incentives that were in the Inflation Reduction Act extended. John mentioned there are only two more years of that incentive. That's not enough time for your investors to feel comfortable that it's going to be there in 3 years. Right? So there's a piece of that. It's just educating and talking about it. And really thank all of you for being here to learn about this, I would say, niche topic, but obviously close to my heart.
And Melanie, how are you talking to your employees about this? You have a huge employee base who I have to guess flies a bunch. How are you talking to them about the work that you all are doing with SAF, with Alaska? How are you encouraging them to behave in the best ways?
Well, the first was making sure everybody understands where our emissions and footprint comes from and the role that travel and aviation and fuel, because it's not just the flights that employees take. It's also including the fuel to move our products around the world and move our devices around the world. And so letting them know that, you know, this is a wedge that we care about. This is a wedge that we're actually taking proactive action on to look at where the innovation is, to reduce the carbon content of that, to find new innovative ways to scale that marketplace that we're going to need to continue to move these products, move our humans around in a way that is aligned with our sustainability commitments, including trying to be carbon negative by 2030. The other piece that we're really lucky to have is we have a 9,000 plus employee base as part of the Sustainability Connected community that I'm an executive sponsor of. And so we can use that forum to educate and inform employees of what we're doing on sustainable aviation, what they could be doing. And to your point about choices, making sure that not only do, you know, the person on the Alaska.com, I think that's right, website, can know where they can choose, but when you're booking your ticket or in your personal capacity as an employee, where your choices lie as well. So I think these are just ways where they're easy access tools. And luckily, we get to be part of coalitions that offer, whether it's the Project Runway initiative that we launched to make it easier for corporates to buy SAF, or ways just to educate policymakers and other corporate leaders. That, I think, is the first hurdle, is just letting people know where the resources are to get started on their own journey.
Well, thank you all for helping to educate us on this topic. And thank you again to our airline partner, Alaska Airways.